So you just got done watching Godzilla vs. Kong, and now you're probably wondering, how in the world did they do that? How did they bring a creature that doesn't exist to life and make it look so real? Stay tuned, because I'm going to tell you how the creative artists at MPC pulled it off. The biggest challenge that artists at MPC faced was the amount of details that was required to create Godzilla. Here's Klaus from MPC.
So you get, okay, you have to do Godzilla, but how do you do it? How do you sculpt a lizard or a big creature like this? You're gonna see his foot up full screen, a nail is the size of a car. One of the challenges of this is, of course, you have to sculpt the whole thing, Abizin. There's basically no hiding.
Yeah, it's probably like one of the most heavy seabird sculpting. And as you can see, he's pretty, like on a big screen, this is pretty full on close up. So that was like one of the main challenges, you know, like all the detail that's in there.
Because of the sheer size of Godzilla, the way they tackled the design with the director and producers of the movie might surprise you.
You don't just sculpt all of Godzilla and then you present at the end and say, this is Godzilla, now it's done. That's not how it works. So a lot of times we might work on a hand and you sculpt the nails and you present it. And the supervisor, who in this case was Guillaume, so you present something like that and he can then approve it. Or if it's something, a major change, like these fins that were down here were not in the original concept model, so they were added in later. So major design changes like this has to go through the director or the client. You work on it in stages, so you might say, okay, so now this is done, boom. So now we can keep going on the head. And then you might have Tamar or somebody who's doing concept modeling or concept sculpting, sculpt on the hand. You present that one, and then that gets approved. You can then move on to the feed or whatever. So the whole thing is dissected into sections and everything gets presented or everything gets approved per section, basically.
Before MPC worked on Godzilla, multiple concepts were created from different artists and different studios. Here's Ian Joyner.
This image was never seen by the director because when he came in, the amazing guys at Weta had done, and other people, I shouldn't take away from anybody else who worked early on stages, but they had tons of initial designs. But it's funny because some of the ideas that I initially had of him being like a big kind of lumbering beast, it was great to see that they kept that in because that's one of my favorite aspects of the old silly, you know, rubber suit, was that he wasn't like a lean, mean T-Rex. He was this just giant thing. So when we got in, my job on it was to do more polish passes, really. Once again, kind of taking their initial stuff. I worked out the head a lot. I did a lot of some anatomy changes and a lot of scale work. At this point, I've done a lot of scales. But it was a very fun project to work on. I love the character. So it was funny because we did a lot of work on the feet, the size of the tail, the size of the head. Initially, his head was like a little pea up there. And finally, they said, no, it's got to be bigger because he's going to be so scaled up, it's going to look like nothing up there. So there's a lot of work on just figuring out the right scale of things and then the right scales on things.
So how did the team tackle all of the details of Godzilla while still staying true to the design language? If you've watched our previous video on how the artists at Disney designed their iconic characters, you might have already guessed it.
You of course get the concept and you get the initial brief, and then you say, how do you do it and what do we need to be able to create this? Because we can't just, like, reference is one of the most key parts before starting anything. We have so many supervisors who, or maybe newer artists who come in sometimes and they start sculpting something or modeling something, and they present it and the supervisors will always go, where's your reference?
Yeah.
So that's the thing. A lot of the times, we might get a concept model, and there might be some lines or some hints of design sculpted in there. But a lot of the times, it's just a gestural thing or a rough thing. So we kind of have to go in and say, okay, so is there something on this planet Earth that looks like this, or we can take and bend into looking like the concept? So the like this turtle shells here, for instance, were done for the back scales of Godzilla.
And this is, you can see like this stuff, you can see the fins are sort of following this. Like we're trying to match photoreal stuff, so we need to have a lot of references. This is some of the early references. And like stuff like this is great, especially when you're sculpting, you know, you see all these little shapes, and this is what we try to achieve basically.
So these are some of the design changes that might happen at MPC, because sometimes maybe the concept is a bit loose or it wasn't really finalized in that area, so we have to kind of go in and sculpt it up and basically make it more real. So we base it on real stuff.
The next time you watch your favorite characters on the big screen, you'll know a little bit more of how they might have been brought to life. If you enjoyed watching this video, please hit that like and subscribe button, as well as letting us know what you'd like to see by leaving a comment down below. If you want to check out the full presentation from our ZBrush convention, where MPC goes in depth with their 3D process, I'll leave a link down below if you'd like to check it out. If you want to try your hand at creating something in 3D yourself, I'll leave a link to the free version of the same program the team at MPC uses in the description. This is Kingsley from Pixelogic. Happy ZBrushing.